it might be a little late to ask. Well, what do you do? Could you tell us? I think I might be the only one.
Maro mujhe, maro.
You guys are fantastic at handling conflict, at handling problems. Let's move on to the bigger problem that we are facing right now. And that is this goddamn virus that nobody can see with the naked eye. Aishwarya, starting with you, how has business been affected?
First thing, in terms of impact of COVID, I think I can divide that into two parts. One is how us as Launchpad has gotten affected. And the second would be how we have had to adapt our work for clients, you know, in terms of their communication. So definitely, like for us, when the first lockdown happened, like if I had to draw a timeline, the first reaction was panic, especially for our retainer clients. So our model is 70% retainers and we have 30% one-time projects. So all our retainers freaked out instantly because their businesses are closed down and they're like, how are we supposed to afford a retainer for a service provider? You know, we have to take care of our own team. But as like time went, I actually noticed like as soon as we hit April, May, suddenly everybody realized that this lockdown is here to stay. And the only thing that they can do right now is communicate with their audience using online channels. So basically, suddenly people realize that we are actually the only ones they should have on board right now, you know, because they can't sell a product or a service, but they can continue to, you know, communicate with their audiences during a crisis. So coming to the second part of the answer, which is how did we have to adapt our work for our clients? Like, I'm going to just kind of, you know, move into that using this point, which is one of our clients, Maybase, is India's first organic, vegan, cruelty-free spa and salon. Now, we all know that spas and salons have been hit terribly. They're probably going to be the last people to open, you know. So, I mean, one of the last after, before restaurants and hotels. But anyway, so with these guys, we obviously have to be really sensitive when we're communicating with the audience at this time. However, we had built this brand over the past 4 years to ensure that just beauty and skincare is not the only thing that they can depend on. We had built layers for this brand. So this brand also stood for social causes like ethical beauty, it stood for veganism, it stood for animal welfare. So we were very seamlessly able to switch our communication to that during COVID. And even the clients saw value in that because we were starting to now see genuine, like who is our genuine audience who is following us even minus the product and services, you know. We have people communicating with us even regardless of that. So I think that way it's been a really exciting exercise to, you know, like just switch our communication style overnight and still see success with that.
Like you spoke about people or the audience that is brand loyal per se, despite not being able to push out the product or despite not exactly marketing just the product, you end up filtering out the people who are not sort of believers in the actual ideology behind your product. So that is a good thing. Like, you know, like you mentioned veganism and stuff like that. Like that sort of ends up into a social cause of its own. And CSR is not just monetary. It's also sort of what you believe in.
So phase started off with us losing a client, which we were almost going to close. It was quite a big client. And we couldn't really do anything about it because she was based out of UK and it was in the education sector. Schools were shut. There's no option. She could not have signed up with us. So it started off with that. But we felt we were going to be hit majorly, but that didn't really happen because we were also associated with a lot of F&B companies in the e-commerce industry. So that kind of worked in our favor. So we, and luckily, we had just closed a project around February beginning. So that had going us through the lockdown. So I wouldn't say we were completely affected, but the influx of inquiries reduced a lot. So what we started doing is, you know, we started moving our strategy. Initially, we would only take end-to-end projects. For example, if it's a website, we would not take only a special section of the website, but we would do the entire website. But then we shifted our approach saying that, okay, there are a lot of people who are still working on their website. They are using this time to improve small, small things on their website. So we took that as an opportunity and we were like, okay, let us help you out in that. We might have not done that earlier, but we will do that for you right now. So that kind of worked, and we started taking up these smaller deals, and that also helped us to keep ourselves busy. It helped to keep our team also busy. So it was a win-win for us. But because we work with a lot of industry, what we realized is that the fashion industry was hit a lot because, I mean, they had to shut their factories, and, you know, nobody is going to buy clothes. They're just going to be sitting in their pajamas at home. So that was affected a lot. So in fact, two of these clients that we work with, they're in the fashion industry, and one of them was mentioning that the reason why people started manufacturing or started selling masks on these platforms is so that they come under the essential category and they can open their factories. So that's the whole reason why these masks started, which is very interesting for us to find out. And yeah, they had no other option but to do this. So yeah, one of the major hit industry we saw was fashion. And a major industry that actually worked and there were new entrants in that was female hygiene, which is quite surprising. I mean, it was happening earlier also, but like, obviously, women, if they are on their period, they're not going to stop wearing pads, come what may. So we saw a lot of new people entering the market also. People just came into this and it fell under the essential category. So yeah, I mean, that's how it has impacted us and how we've seen it's impacted other industries.
15th of March is where we sort of started seeing that people pulled plug on our retailers, and they were like, we are not sure when we are going to reopen, what's going to happen, it's so uncertain, and we would want to maintain our internal teams and having vendors. And they were obviously letting go of a lot of vendors in their organizations, and of course we were part of it. And that was a very justifiable move. I don't put anyone in, like, I think that's an unfortunate event for everyone, and everyone was sort of impacted with it. But as even Ashwarya said, that communication is something that people now are realizing that this is something which is going to be here for a long time, and they cannot shut everything down. And communication, especially because they need to talk to their audience, they need to be in front of the audience. They are changing their own business model, how to tackle this situation, and doing that, being in front of people is really, really important. And understanding how they would react to the product now is something that we are also helping these guys from our friend, because for us, what we noticed is the cost per click has gone down drastically.
Right.
Like, because nobody was advertising at that point, we kept asking the clients, like, we would even do it on pro bono basis. It would definitely be beneficial for the brand to be there and for us to be busy, as Shweta was saying, that keeping us also afloat, as we don't have any team, we don't have the overhead costs on us. Yeah. So therefore, it was easier for us to take pro bono, where we could say that this is something that now we can offer. Not something beyond this also, because we need to keep ourselves also secured from a way where it doesn't go on into a space where it's everything and we are doing everything on social.
Sure, of course, it's a business at the end of the day.
Certain services that we were like, we can take on, and few things we will have to let go of it. And I think the clients were also sort of understanding. We had two projects that we were sort of working on retainer. They didn't pause it because they were not in India. Both of them were based out in US. And so yeah, I think they are coming back now. We are getting a lot of inquiries, to be fair. Like, now we are getting, like, we are pitching almost 10 people this week. So from that angle, if you see, people are now realizing that digital is the place to be. And we are seeing new influx of people, which is people who've never thought of being on a digital platform are now thinking to be in front of in front of the digital audience. I think even me and Aishwarya were like sort of pitching one brand together, where it's a heritage hotel and it's really popular in their own area and a particular kind of niche audience, and they never spent money on advertising. Never is the word. It's all through word of mouth, and it's a non-profit organization. That's what they were earlier, and now not anymore, obviously. And they've changed the structure also of the organization, and we realized that a lot of people, and these people are in their 60s, you know, and it's difficult for them to like trust anyone because this is a digital space they've never touched upon. They have no idea of how it operates, and they're just there because they want to like, they know that that is where the audience is right now. Sure. And having said that, I think for digital space, it is going to be slow, but it is not going to be like as bad as the real estate sector. Yes. I think we all keep getting some sort of work. Maybe the money that we were quoting earlier is not something that we can quote right now because there is no money in the economy. We all have to take a little bit hit from that side, but I think we will be on a safer side where we can at least get our rents out. I mean, that's what rents and like survival is what we can do.
What I can tell you is the industry is dead. Events are dead. And this is me putting it very lightly. Okay, people aren't going to get married in you know, with that kind of a scale anymore. People are not going to have the dispensable cash to splurge on every occasion that they would otherwise have splurged on. People don't necessarily, even the corporates, right, whatever funding they have, they're not now pushing it into actual manufacturing, actual marketing with you guys. They're pushing it on different avenues in general, which are going to, in fact, help the product or the service rather than sort of, you know, on like trainings and stuff like that or dealer meets or things that I would generally do. In terms of concerts and commercial events, well, where the hell are you going to get the sponsorship from? Because these companies are using their CSR funds for themselves, trying to backtrack their way into pushing the money back, trying to say, you know what, we don't have anything to declare till like October, November now. Fuck it, let's just put everything back and then let's figure a way out to externally get it audited and go from there. And just hope to God that the tax cut still stands, right? So people are doing everything they can to keep money away from the event industry per se. And now it's just the only events you can get is brand activation. So like in malls and in different venues in general, that's the only, and those aren't events. Those are like, I don't know what to call them. Right? Those are just me displaying a goddamn car in a mall. Like that is stupid. So like right now, even product launches, you actually like everyone is silently launching products now. Like there are products being released, and at the most you see TV commercials and you see like online ad campaigns, and that's about it. There's no actual launch event that's happening. So what do you do, right? As an event entrepreneur, what do you do? So we are hit terribly. But the worst part is you can't, if you're in the event industry, you can't exactly spring back from it very easy either. Because again, the whole point about having dispensable cash is going to last you a while. The rates are going to, like Akanksha mentioned, I'm going to have to take hits. But the hits are going to be so bad that I might actually have, like the industry won't give me hits. My vendors aren't going to try and absorb my hits. Because what they're going to say is, so we didn't work for an entire season. We need money. So we're not going to take hits. Maybe on like a personal level or actually the way informal sector is, it works on personal connections more. So based on that, maybe they'll give me a better deal than they otherwise would have. But beyond that, what? There is very little to earn for event guys. So like now I think the event industry needs to sort of evolve. This has sort of helped the event industry get into a space where now we need to look at avenues that are virtual, that are web-based. We need to take everything we know about a physical event, on-ground event, all the field knowledge that we have, we need to take it to a platform that is not tangible. And to that, I have to say, good luck guys. Because honestly, that doing that is a huge challenge, right? Everyone's going to suffer one by one, right? Like we are suffering, artists are going to suffer, celebrities are going to suffer, everyone's going to come down together, right? So now that the whole thing is, let's see which way this shit goes. And we're just sitting back, laughing at our own plights and saying, kya karna hai? Like you mentioned, people that weren't exactly considering coming onto digital platforms are now coming on. Like I can talk about events like, one of the things that people are doing right now, which is, I think as an event guy, it's an absolute abomination, is online concerts. It makes me want to shoot myself in the head because I'm like, concerts and any kind of events in general, a huge part of that is the actual ambience. Like if you don't have the fucking ambience for it, like what the hell are you doing at the event, right? So creating that has sort of become a handicap, right? Mm-hmm. But I think even here, like this is where you have to be a good entrepreneur. This is where you have to start showing your adaptability and start saying stuff like, okay, what do we do next? Where do we go from here, right? My solution, let's open a YouTube channel. Let's try monetizing it. Let's direct all the traffic back to events. This kind of innovation is what people need to come up with in general. I also want to take this opportunity to tell all my friends and people in the event industry, Instagram or Facebook Live se ghanta kuch nahi hone wala tumhara, stop doing it.
Thank God, yes.
Yeah. So it's not going to help you. Your reach is not going to increase. You want followers, go buy them. So we are in a tough spot. This brings me to this section of the video where I want you guys to be babas. What message do you guys have for your clients, for the companies in this duration?
I would suggest brands to give a seat to their marketing teams when they are making business decisions. In a sense that previously what used to happen is that they would make the decision internally as entrepreneurs and then pass on the information to us and then figure out, you guys marketed, get your PR and blah, 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 right? Now the change that is happening is that they don't have the expertise to figure out how to change it into an online model and still continue their business. So I would really encourage all brand owners to give us a seat at that table and help us brainstorm and let us help us change your models for you, you know, and be able to adapt it together.
I don't have a very elaborate message, but it would be actually common, not just to clients, but to everyone. Don't stop trying. Okay. Like, I mean, I've heard a lot of clients telling me, oh shit, you know, I don't know what to do. Hum toh ghar hi baith rahe. But no, I mean, you still can try. There is still a way to reach out to your users, communicate with them, or maybe rethink your strategy. This is the time where you can think and try a lot of things within your domain also. So I also see a lot of people stopping their risk. I mean, their risk appetite has kind of reduced in this phase, which I understand why, but don't shy away from trying, you know, with the thing that, oh, agar main ye karunga ya karungi, then I will not achieve it because of COVID. You know, I've heard that so many times and I have reached a point where I'm like, no, COVID is, it may be here for a long time, but it's not permanent. And it doesn't mean that it's the end of the world.
Don't stop marketing. I mean, if it cost you $100 to get a customer before this started, it costs you $50 right now on social media platforms. So, you know, when the whole thing
started, sorry to interject, but it's costing them 50 rupees because you guys are willing to take the hit for it. Let's also not forget that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just saying that if earlier you had to hire us, you would have to spend so much media budget to get it on advertising to get the customer. Now you'd have to spend much lesser.
And even even for us, as we just said, that we understand where the brands are and the problems that they are facing. We are all, anyway, like every one of us on this roundtable, I think, is doing their best to help them out, to give them the best sort of presence that they can get on digital. Having said that, do not stop your activities. Pausing it doesn't help. Being active is what you can do. Try to figure out a balance of paid to organic is what I would say. If you don't have budgets, talk it out to your vendors. Tell them where you are. Tell them the kind of budget you have. And I am sure that everyone will do their best to help you out in that budget itself. What is the best solution for it? I think people, clients sort of shy away in sharing what their media budgets are. And that has been a very big challenge for us because they think that if I share them, that I will tell them 1 lakh is my media budget, they will try to take more money out of me. I think that's a wrong approach. We all understand 1 lakh is required because to reach, even have a small presence on digital, it costs a little bit. It's equal to an offline. And I keep saying this and I think I want to say this out loud. If you are new on a digital platform, please do not expect any returns immediately. It's like setting your offline channel. It's like setting an offline store. You do not see a return in the first month or the second month. It's a progress. It's an effort. You keep doing it. You keep testing it. The best part of digital is if you are spending 10,000 rupees, you will know what is it that you are achieving through that 10,000. So do not expect returns immediately. Having said that, no returns is also something that you should not go
for. Especially for businesses who are shut right now, who are offline businesses. I think that even you guys should be investing in social media, investing in advertising, because it acts as an investment, right? That you're building up the awareness now so that at some point things are going to open. And you know, when they open, like, people are going to remember you. So it makes sense.
Studies Kellogg's, guys, just go and read Kellogg's. That's what I would say. How did they build their brand while in the crisis? It's the best case study, and you will understand why you need to invest on digital as of now. I think that's the best case study I can think of.
I'm actually happy you brought up Kellogg's wala case study, because I still believe that budget to ek bahana hai. At least in, I think tier 1 cities are much ahead of everyone else in this, but tier 2 and tier 3 cities and towns, okay, like I can vouch for that. I can tell you, people don't exactly understand the importance of branding. No matter how big or small you are, they don't understand how it is important to reach out and why it makes business sense to reach out, because they are happy with their tiny niche market, their tiny reach, and, you know, sort of consolidating whatever they have. They are happy doing that. And that sort of limits them and limits their understanding of how branding works, especially in a time like this. Let's talk about what your message is to people in general right now, especially those who are entering this whole digital marketing. There's a ton of people who want to enter the market. What is your message to them?
I think a key word that I have learned right now is future-proofing. So, which is basically like, I mean, we are taking this time to prioritize ourselves to figure out how to future-proof launchpad communication based on whatever's happening right now. So, you know, that could involve analyzing the services that we're providing right now to see, do we need to narrow it down? Do we need to maybe add new services that people now require? You know, things like that. Basically, what direction do we need to go, and how do we kind of build an infra around us so that post-COVID, or if something like this were to happen again, how will we remain relevant?
In addition to everything that Aishwarya just mentioned, I feel like, you know, now people, or even us, like the gig economy, or even in general, people should stop competing with each other and rather collaborate with each other to achieve a certain goal, because it's done. Competition is done. Like, you know, Sid, you mentioned in the beginning, everybody's kind of doing the similar thing. You know, why not just collaborate and reach an end goal rather than compete with each other and bash the other person out? So yeah, that's pretty much that. Collaborate, don't compete.
That applies to everyone. So all these idiots making TikTok versus YouTube videos, please listen out loud. Don't bring other people down. I understand that TikTok versus YouTube bana ke bhi tum dono platforms ko elevate kar rahe ho.
Exactly.
Because everyone is getting popular because of it. Let's not kid ourselves.
Collaboration is the way forward, and that's the future as of now. Till the time we don't see any new future in front of us, if I have to say. The new normal is where you are as of now. Don't try to, you know, fight it. I would say just try to find new ways to deal with it. And having said that, I hope everyone has a great mental health right now. I think that is the biggest impact every entrepreneur, every person is facing it. And I think that's going to be my message, not like digitally.
I'm laughing because I'm looking at my phone, I'm looking into camera and talking to you guys. What does that tell you about my
life? This is the only way forward as of now. I don't know what else can I say.
That is important.
I just want to say that skill yourself, like skills will pay your bills. And in this age, there's like hundreds of all kinds of courses are out there. And we can learn a lot of shit, but we tend to, and I'm guilty of this too, we tend to just consume, and we don't think into practice. I think, and I believe, like, choose one or two skills that you really want to get good at. That's what I believe in, and that's what I try to practice. So I hope that would make some sense.
Lovely messages all around.
I wanted to ask, since this is something that came up quite a bit, is, you know, how we're all going to have to take some kind of hit in terms of, you know, how much we're charging. What is everybody's opinion on that? Like, what are you guys thinking in terms of, are you guys planning to reduce your pricing for the same services, or repackage your services to be able to charge lesser?
I think both.
It's a mix of restructuring and also not just putting the price down, but thinking how that, like, restructuring is going
to be.
The biggest irony of this whole situation is that suddenly people have realized that they should have been spending money on this, and now when they've realized it, they can't afford it. that's pretty sad.
We would have to reduce our pricing, obviously, but understand what your clients want, because now even the demands would be changing a bit. You know, they may probably, in your case, they probably would want a certain number of posts, a certain type of a retainer, but now they might need something else. They might lower their demands. Or, I mean, what they want would not be as much as they wanted earlier. So I guess listen to them and adapt the pricing according to that.
That's really, really fair advice, I would say. That's true. Because, you know, see, like, we've got retainers that were closed pre-COVID, and now for the exact same services, they're going to be asking for a lesser price, right? So probably the only thing that we could do is, like you said, is analyze their objectives again and, you know, how things have changed, maybe reduce a couple of things or, you know, balance them out somewhere and then justify it, right? Because otherwise, like, it's very strange for me to think that you can just, like, charge a lesser price for the exact same thing that you were doing for another.
Exactly.
I mean, that's just strange.
In terms of how your services are sort of packaged, you need a new revised way of packaging. I'm not even gonna say like you're gonna have to reduce rates, which you obviously would have to, but at the end of the day, you want to make it a package which is ultra attractive, and you want to clump up as much as you can. You want to be able to use every single resource that your company has in terms of talent, in terms of time. Repackaging the way you market your services, the price point of your services also needs to sort of evolve. Thank you so much for watching this. Thank you guys for coming. Listen, if there's a better place for me to say, please like, share, subscribe. There's never been a better place. Like, this is it. I am with digital marketing guys. They know the importance of this shit. Okay, so I can't stress enough, guys. Like, share, subscribe, karo, kuch nahi hai, free hai. Abhi paisa nahi mang raha hu, paise maange chahe maanga. But let's see. Thank you so much, guys, for coming on. If you grab anything out of this, just understand that these guys are very passionate about what they do, and that they would love to, you know, help you guys out with whatever branding solutions you need. Links down there, guys. Follow them and show them your love. And I'm gonna see you guys next video.
Bye.